When I was a kid and Starkweather started his spree, it was all over the national news, and I was afraid he was going to come to Los Angeles. I vividly remember being afraid that this guy was going to come to Los Angeles and I could be shot, because he was seemed like he was shooting anyone. Didn't matter who it was. I don't think they knew at the time, while they were chasing him, what he was like. It wasn't until after he was captured that they found out what he was like. And then there were interviews with him in jail, that there are, you know, tapes were made, and I think that's when they found out how eccentric he was. And just he had this sort of sense of humor about everything that was going on, and it was so weird and so strange and so eccentric. I think Terry was trying to understand who was Starkweather and what does he really represent, and does he represent something about that part of the country where it's taking place. And but I also think Terry's intentions are about are bigger and more of a sort of a philosophical sense of who are we as people? What is it that makes up a society? There's a shot in Badlands, right near the end of the movie, where you, Sissy and Martin have been arrested and they're flown away in an airplane, and Sissy is doing voiceover about what happened after they got put in jail. And we do a cut to a guy carrying a couple of sacks of mail, which obviously had just arrived, not obviously, but they had just arrived on the plane that flew in, that then flies Sissy and Martin off. And I asked Terry, what is that shot all about? Why are we having that guy carrying the mail? Why do we want to cut to that? And he said, because he's a character that has no idea who's on that plane that's taking off right now. He has no idea that there's a guy on that plane that killed people along his path in life. And he's got other things that he's concerned with. He's got to get the mail delivered. It's his job. And that was important to him, to show that. The way you see Terry best in Badlands is you get to see, in a way, other things that are going on in the world. It's all about what's going on in the universe. It's a real major element of his, of the essence of who he is, and way he thinks about the world and where we live and who we are and where we sit in the scheme of things. I think we were cutting Badlands, starting when we started shooting, I think 15 months. So I think it was about 80,000 feet. On Days of Heaven, I think we had about 120,000 feet. On Thin Red Line, we had over 1 million feet. So, you know, figure there's 6,000 feet of film in an hour, approximately. And it was a difficult edit to cut Badlands because neither one of us knew what we were doing. That made it harder. There was less experimentation with Badlands than anything that followed that. I think the reason that Badlands was like that more than the other pictures is that we were on a very tight budget. He was a first-time director. He wanted to put out there what his original intention was and didn't want to censor himself and just really wanted to see what would happen if he just had faith in what he was trying to do. I think if you look at most first-time directors' first films, they will feel new still. He had a unique script. You know, there's a very early scene in the movie. This might be the first line of on-camera dialogue in the movie. You see Martin and Kit and Cato as garbage men, and they're in an alley collecting the garbage, and they stop. The truck stops. Martin jumps off the truck. He goes over and picks up a can, or goes over to a can of trash, and there's a dead dog in the alley. And Martin says, "Okay, I'll give you $1, Cato, if you eat this collie."
I'll give you $1, eat this collie.
And Cato walks over to it, bends down, looks at it, and he says, I ain't going to eat him for a dollar. I don't think he's a collie either. And I just thought when I saw those dailies, man, this is really a different movie. There was a Truffaut movie called The Wild Child. It's a great movie. Truffaut plays this doctor. He finds a child out in the middle of the woods, a wild child who would bathe the moon at night and raised by animals. That was the idea. And the voiceover, the use of the voiceover is very dramatic and really good. And we loved that voiceover. And so we tried to sometimes, we would refer to that with each other. You know, how can we use the voiceover that we have the way Truffaut used it in The Wild Child? And what it meant was sometimes Truffaut would talk about something The Wild Child had done in the voiceover, and you'd see him actually writing in his journal, and then you'd hear his voice. But then Truffaut would do a thing like, I wonder what would happen if I did this. I had to find out. Gave it a real wonderful dramatic quality.
We'd hide out like spies somewhere in the north where people didn't ask a lot of questions. I could have snuck out the back or hidden the boiler room, I suppose, but I sensed that my destiny now lay with Kit, for better or for worse, and that it was better to spend a week with one who loved me for what I was than years of loneliness.
The way Terry writes voiceover has been an evolutionary process. It started in Badlands. You know, he was trying to write the voiceover for Badlands to make it a little bit sound like a romance magazine, and which was his. He was very conscious of him trying to do that, and not necessarily telling the story, but telling the story through the language of a romance magazine.
That they were gone forever.
But then later, in other movies, we discovered other ways to deal with voiceover. At first, you know, like Days of Heaven was never intended to have voiceover, and then ended up having Linda's voiceover, which became a huge element in it and very memorable aspect of the film. But that came about through experimentation. We first tried writing it. Terry tried writing her voiceover, and it wasn't working very well. And, you know, and this was the same person writing the voiceover that wrote it for Badlands, but it wasn't working. Till we accidentally discovered a great way to tell the voiceover was for Linda to look at a scene and tell us what happened in the scene.
From the time the sun went up till it went down, they were working all the time. No, non-stop, just keep going. You didn't work, they'd ship you right out of there.
It really opened up a whole new world for him to start thinking about it. And then he could write stuff that was more along those lines, and we could combine that with Linda's view of what happened and what Terry wanted her to be saying. It helped a lot. And that was different. The process for Badlands wasn't like that. The process for Badlands was Terry had written the voiceover. He knew what it wanted to sound like, what he wanted it to sound like. And Sissy recorded a bunch of it. And we cut it into the movie. And then we were able to add more when we could see what worked. And so it was experimental a little in Badlands, but then in later movies it became much more of an experimental process. And we ended up recording much more. Badlands, we recorded the smallest amount of voiceover compared to the others. But we used more voiceover in Badlands than we did in the other movies. So it's interesting. The difference.
He never seemed like a violent person before, except for once, when he said he'd like to rub out a couple of guys whose names he didn't care to mention. It all goes to show how you can know a person and not really know him at the same time.
What you realize when you're cutting a movie is that the new script is the film. The old script is what got written on the page, but that's now old, and that doesn't really mean a lot. What matters is the new script, which is the shot footage.
Kit knew the end was coming. He wondered if he'd hear the doctor pronounce him dead, or if he'd be able to read what the papers would say about him the next day from the other side. He dreaded the idea of being shot down alone, he said.
The voiceover is like adding music. It really changes. And you realize it gives you a different rhythm to the editing and a different rhythm, overall rhythm to the movie. And so it makes it, you end up wanting to recut and based on the voiceover, and then maybe changing the voiceover, redoing some of it. And so it's such a big influence, the voiceover, that and then what it also allows you to do is create montages in areas that weren't necessarily intended to be montages, or they weren't intended to be split up the way they got split up. There's sections of the movie that were script-wise were intended to all be together. There's a montage of Martin working in the feed yard, the livestock yard, and it's cut up now into a montage with Sissy's voiceover, and you see Martin at work, and then you see a scene with Sissy, and then you might see part of a scene with Sissy and Martin, and then you go back to the feedlot again and see Martin working some more. And that happened because of the voiceover. That came about because of the voiceover allowed us to do it, and you didn't feel like you were jumping around a lot. It all felt like one piece. At the same time, we were experimenting with music all during the same time. And so because we used a lot of the Carl Orff music all through the movie, and we already had that records of that music, so we could experiment with it beforehand. And that, combined with the voiceover, really guided us through the editing a lot.
One day, while taking a look at some vistas in Dad's stereopticon, it hit me that I was just this little girl, born in Texas, whose father was a sign painter, who had only just so many years to live.
Terry had heard the Carl Orff music that we ended up using in the movie. He had heard it earlier when he was writing a movie for Irv Kirshner, the director Irv Kirshner. And Kirshner had knew the Orff, Carl Orff music, and he played it for Terry and said he was thinking about using it. It was a movie that never got made. And so Terry fell in love with it and thought that it would be perfect for Badlands. And part of the reason he thought it would be perfect is that music is all kids playing it, and it was written as a way to teach children music, and it's a whole series of records, actually. It was played by children, and that's what we're using. We're using the original recordings in the movie.
Sometimes I wished I could fall asleep and be taken off to some magical land, but this never happened.
There's a couple of pieces in it that have choral sections to it, with young women singing, and it's all in German. And so we went to a recording studio and recorded people, another choral section in English, to play along with it, to sort of cloud the German, because we didn't want people to think we were making a statement with German singing. We didn't want to give it a political statement, a fascistic statement, or anything like that. So we wanted to sort of confuse the choral aspect of it. And you can hear it when you watch the movie. You can hear that section. I don't know if you can pick up the German part of it or not, but we definitely did an English section of choral to sort of just cloud that choral part, but not take away from it. Badlands is full of dialogue. It's a talky movie. For a Terry movie, it's very talky.
Try to keep an open mind. Try to understand the viewpoints of others. Consider the minority opinion, but try to get along with the majority of opinion once it's accepted.
And that's because we were following the script. Terry tends to write a lot of dialogue, even though his movies don't always have a lot of dialogue. He writes a lot of dialogue, and it's just how it turns out when he shoots, whether or not he likes it, whether or not, and it's not because the actors didn't do it well, it's whether or not he likes it once he shoots it. Does he like that dialogue? Does he feel a little skittish about it? Or maybe it's too over the top, or maybe it's too clear. Maybe it's too on the nose what they're doing. So he'll take it out and we'll just try it without dialogue. So, but Badlands, because it was the first movie, he didn't know necessarily that he could get away with that. It wasn't until Days of Heaven that we discovered that.
I didn't mind telling Kit about stuff like this.
We did encounter some technical problems during the making of the movie, but we overcame them pretty much.
For instance,
we had the first shot in the movie of Sissy in bed with her dog, and the camera pulls back. It was almost, we couldn't even see an image in the dailies that came through, but we then, in the color timing, we were able to push the light through so that you could now. It doesn't look like that, but on film, on a large screen, it's pretty grainy because we really pushed it hard so that you could see it. And then there's another shot later in the movie of Martin in bed. I think we pull back on that also. He's just sitting in bed. And they were shot at the same time. They both had the same problem. You could barely see an image. We didn't know if we were going to be able to use it, but we ended up being able to use it. And then there's another scene in the movie where Martin and Sissy first meet, and they walk down the street and have a conversation. And the day we shot that scene, something wasn't connected properly in the camera, so the shutter was flying. It was unusable, every bit of footage. And we didn't know it until it came back from the lab. So that entire day had to be reshot. So that was hard, especially on a low budget film, and it's like losing a day, and that's expensive, and it's hard. You don't want to put the actors through the same scene again, and it was all problems that every movie has. And but because we were so low budget, it made it a little harder because, you know, we didn't have money for anything. When he's got the gun over his shoulders and he's standing out at dusk, just looking around, and we see a storm brewing in the distance and the clouds, and then he looks at some animals, which I think two of those shots, the animals are stuffed, because I think they didn't come up with that shot until they were driving back to town one night, and they didn't have any, there weren't any animals out there. But somebody had a couple of stuffed animals, maybe Jack, in his car. So he put them out there. And because it was low light, kind of dusky, magic hour, we figured we'd get away with it. It was a combination of maybe we get away with it and maybe who cares that they're stuffed. It's okay. And then there's one shot that has a bird in it that looks like it's stuffed, and all of a sudden it turns its head, so it's alive. And that made it seem like, well, it looks like it's stuffed till it turns its head, so maybe people will think, well, the other ones just didn't move yet. We cut away before they moved so that you wouldn't think they were stuffed. I don't think people realize they're stuffed. And but that was just a shot that Terry had shot that wasn't shot at the same time. And but we color timed it so it matched lighting wise everything. But Terry's all of his movies are full of sequences like that. He realizes that it helps to shoot those clean shots because you can use them in situations like that. So now he does it all the time.
Whatever the expression, I told him we couldn't go.
Terry wanted a final image in the movie. He wanted it to be what it is. He wanted a shot of flying through clouds. But we didn't really have a shot to go off on. All we had was the close-up of Martin and Sissy in the plane, which are kind of dull shots, and they're not in the air. You know, it's not, you can't shoot out the window and see that they're in the air. So we looked at a ton of stock footage, of cloud footage, and then we saw this footage, I think originally was shot in 65mm, that was from Ice Station Zebra, and it was meant as plate shots wasn't meant to be, they weren't meant to be shots of clouds that were just cloud shots to be in the movie. They were plate shots that you, they were going to put planes in and stuff like that. And you could buy it. And so we picked one we really liked and bought, you know, however long it is, 30 feet, something like that. I had no doubts about Terry at all from the first day's worth of dailies. I just thought he was different, but certainly I always felt like he knew what he wanted. I mean, this he wasn't like he was shooting a movie out in the dark and was just hoping it would go, it would work. He knew what he wanted to try and do. I personally, as an editor, I don't believe a movie can be saved in the editing room. I know there's an expression that it can be. I don't believe in that. I believe that the first cut of a movie that you see is the movie. You cannot change the essence of the movie. You can make it move faster. You can shift scenes around, but I don't believe it can be saved. You can tell in the first cut whether or not it works. And then you just make it better. And, you know, when the first cut of Badlands is what Badlands is, we just made it shorter.